This is a Frank podcast. Hey guys, yeah. Welcome to the Wellington Paranormal podcast.
Are you talking to us or them?
Oh, who knows? My name is Mike Minogue.
Hello, my name's Karen O'Leary.
My name's Maaka Pohatu.
Yeah, that's right. And this week our guest is Maaka Pohatu. Yay! Yeah.
He just said that.
He played Sarge. He didn't say he was the guest. He was just here. And people were like, who's this guy?
I just showed up.
Who's this new dude? Yeah. So we're going to have a yarn to you, Maaka, about how you came to be on Wellington Paranormal and your general experiences and what you're doing now and all sorts of stuff, I reckon.
Yeah, we've got some pretty big questions.
We've got them and they're all in our heads.
Yep.
We had them written down, some of them, and our printer doesn't work.
Yeah, ran out of paper.
Ink or something, yeah. So, yeah, who knows how this is going to go. but, yes, well, first of all, let me ask you, Maaka, why acting?
Why acting? Oh, that's a tough big question, eh? I never wanted to be an actor originally. I wanted to be a chef.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because I love eating. Yeah, and I like making food.
Yeah.
And then I saw how stressful it gets in the kitchen, and I was like, nah, stuff that.
Was it Gordon Ramsay put you off?
Yeah.
I don't want him swearing at me.
A lot of chefs like that.
Right.
They were like, man, if I want to be Gordon Ramsay's out here.
Yeah, did you find out just through diners. Experience?
Yeah.
Yeah, but they all do have a bad attitude. Why is that? Why don't they just cheer up?
It's just really high
pressure,
stress,
isn't it?
High pressure, trying to pump out.
What, dishes?
Exactly. Yeah.
Especially when it gets to you earlier and you don't even eat it because you're not hungry.
No, but I'm. Whatever. So you decided not to become a chef and you thought, you know what, will be way less stressful.
Like,
becoming a full time actor.
Yeah. Totally. So I first saw my mum act and I used to, when I was a kid, and I used to help be her prompt. Like,
right.
When she was learning lines and stuff, and I was like real strict. I was like, nah, mum, you're supposed to say this. You said this and you're supposed to say that. But I saw her acting when I was a kid and I thought, oh, yeah. But I didn't think anything of it.
Shout out to your mum. What's your mum's name?
Shout out to my mum.
Is she just mum?
Emma Tuturua. Tangiariki Pohatu. Thank you.
Oh, beautiful.
Yeah. It's her birthday today too. December
4th. Happy birthday,
is it?
Mum?
Yeah.
Oh, happy birthday. I would get, Zara would do, we've spoken about this before, but Zara would do my offlines.
Uh-huh.
But I had to stop that.
You fired her, didn't you?
Oh, yeah, she's gone. Because she would start acting. She'd start treating it like it was, she was on Shortland Street. Mm. And I was like, do not do that.
When were you reading lines for Shortland
Street? Well, I have done that. Have you had an audition for Shortland Street?
Oh, it's an amazing show, but I've declined offers.
Right, yeah. I got, yeah. Well, I thought, for me, it was after I spoke to Tom Sainsbury. I was what was that like? Yeah. And he was like, I had a ball. I got to be the bad guy. Yeah. On a soap opera and be a real scumbag. And he had so much fun. I was like, yeah, exactly. Yeah, that'd be right. So anyway, I had an audition, didn't get the part. Yeah. Probably because of the way my wife was reading lines to me.
It was her fault.
God, I managed to put a blame back on her. And so what was your mum's, what was her relationship with acting? She'd always done it? Was she full time? What was?
Like, both my parents were lecturers at Otago University and they had relationships with all the other departments, but they had quite a strong, the Māori department had quite a strong relationship with the theatre department down there. And so they had like cultural exchange and, drama kind of theatre exchange. So I kind of grew up around that. But yeah, after high school, I did a couple of plays for Takirua in Wellington. And still wasn't sure. Try to study theatre at Otago Uni.
Was it you weren't sure because you went with James Ashcroft?
No,
James Ashcroft was sort of like the Gordon Ramsay of directing.
No, well, this was back in 97.
Before.
I was like 17, 18 at the time. So I dabbled in it, but it didn't really,
didn't grab
really
you.
Land with me until I tried to study it at uni and then all of the theory and the stuff went over my head, but I kind of liked the practical side. And then my tutor at the time gave me a prospectus for Toi Whakaari, the New Zealand Drama School, and I went and did that. And then, yeah. So.
Don't really like this, but I'll try it.
I'd like to,
but it's quite, isn't
to
it, like a, it's a not toy. It's not easy to get into toy, is it?
No,
so you must have had some sort of skill.
There was a whole,
was it three auditions you got to do? It's a long process.
There was two. There was like your regional one, and then you got a callback audition at drama school in Wellington. There was a whole weekend process. So, yeah, it's quite late. It was like a really long, drawn out audition.
Yeah,
where they put you through different. You had to learn a couple of monologues, and then from there they would put you through this weekend intensive when you got a callback, and then yeah, you got a letter. At the end of it,
declined.
Yeah, but this is the thing. When I got my letter of acceptance, I rang my parents and I opened it and said, "Oh, I got in." But at the time, my then girlfriend didn't know, so I was like, "Oh, cool, yeah." And they're like, "Oh, congratulations, boy, you got in, yeah." And I was like, "Okay, cool. I'm going to seal it up again." And so when Brandon gets here, I'll open it up and use my acting skills and go, "Oh, look, I got in." Oh. And then I had to ring my parents in front of her and have the conversation again.
Oh my god!
Hey, mom and dad, I got it in. And then they're on the other side, cracking up. Oh wow! So
how long did that relationship last?
Till the end of second year drama school.
Oh, that's pretty good.
Yeah,
good.
Who else was in your cohort? Anyone that we might know the names of?
In my original year was Te Kohe Tuhaka, Simbu Filipo, Lawson Quarter.
Yep.
Who else? Jay Daniels.
Pretty good lineup.
Yeah.
And the year above was Tim Foley.
Tim Foley, yeah.
James Ashcroft.
Was
Miriamma in that one? Miriamma.
No, she was in the
one up.
The year above,
yeah.
This is my year. A whole bunch of people in my
nobody's
year.
Nobody's mean. You forgot
them
all.
People that you don't remember.
Yeah. Well, stink actors. You were saying off air. You said they all stink.
Well, I think they all went on to be teachers. And
chefs. Everybody's listening again. Say my name. But you also had a pretty tight relationship with music growing up. Is that right?
Yeah. Both my parents were, my dad would compose some waiata and haka.
Because what was he the lecturer for? What were both your parents doing, actually? Oh,
my dad was the head of Māori studies at Otago Uni from 1986 to 96. And my mum was a senior teaching fellow, another senior lecturer of the Māori studies department.
Mate, you would have had to be good, eh?
Yeah. He's also probably one of the youngest HODs.
Right.
The youngest.
So they're in Dunedin.
Mm.
When did they go to Martin?
After they left uni around 96, yeah. So my dad grew up in Martin. They moved back there around 2000.
Yeah, right.
For people around the world that don't know about Martin, it's a pretty, like a really bustling metropolis in the lower North Island.
So what is the population?
Huge. I wouldn't know.
It's probably about...
Well, yeah, I mean, I was down the road from there. So it's in the Manawatū, which is... And Levin's not far away. I think it's about half an hour away. I think when I was growing up in Levin, it was about 19 or 20,000 there. It's been going down ever since. diminishing population. But, yeah, you're just up the road. And then, O'Leary, you were just down the road in Wellington there. So we weren't far away from it. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, the Martin
must have been less because it's a very agricultural sort of setup.
2,000 people, surely.
Well, he doesn't
back
know.
In the day.
I don't know.
And then, so what was the toy setup like? Was that enjoy? You made it through, I'm assuming. You graduated.
Yeah.
Not everybody does.
Yeah. You had the sort of like five main classes, my main kind of disciplines at the time. There's like voice, movement, improv. There was the Taha Māori component, and there was also like history and theory practice, right. Kind of. Yeah.
But it's busy, eh? Like it's 5 days a week, full days.
Yeah.
Yeah, hectic. So it's got to be good for you so that when you finally get out in the – what was it like though when you went out and you got an agent and then – because I don't think they teach you anything about what it's like to be on set or anything. What was the first sort of job that you got involved with?
Lots of kind of – like university student short film roles.
Yeah, let's forget about those. What about one that paid you?
Can we still find them on the internet?
yeah. Oh, I started doing heaps of theatre straight after school.
Oh, yeah. And then what was your first sort of payment? Because you talked about, I think we've spoken before, you did Girl Meets Boy.
Yeah.
Girl Meets Boy, yeah.
Good. Did a couple of scenes in that. And that's where I met Paul Yates.
Yeah.
And, yeah, that was the first kind of regular TV series gig. But my first proper feature was called Two Little Boys.
From Boy Meets Girl. Girl Meets, and which way around is it?
Girl Meets Boy and
yeah,
then
boy two, little boys. Boys.
Two Little Boys. Yeah.
Yeah, got rid of the girl, yeah. Got another boy in.
Yeah, just three boys.
Three boys, yeah. And who was in that?
Brett McKenzie and Hamish Blake.
Yeah.
And that was directed by Rob Sarkis and it was based on Duncan Sarkis' novel. And we shot it in the Catlins around the beginning of 2010 or 2011-ish.
Yeah, right. Yeah. So that was not long before we started doing Shadows, and then Yatesy just called you up, and what was the call like for getting involved in paranormal?
Yeah, well, at the time, I can't remember what year it was, but it had to be, when we start shooting season one, like?
2016?
We still don't know.
We don't know, but we're going to find out.
Well, somewhere around that time.
We've previously known.
Yeah, he rang me out of the blue and he goes, "Hey, Mike, it's Paul Yatesy, how are you going?" I was like, "Yeah, good, man, how are you?" And he's like, yeah, he just got straight to the thing. He was like, "Have you seen what we've done Shadows yet?" And I was like, "Yeah, yeah." I went to the Auckland premiere and dressed up as a vampire. Even.
Oh, yeah.
And it was great. Why is that? He goes, "Oh, do you remember the two cops? Yeah, they go to the vampire's flat."
Yeah.
I was like, "Yeah, they were great. They're funny." Yeah. And he goes, "Well, we want to make a spin-off series and would you be interested in being in it?" I was like, "Sure, you want me to audition?" They're like, no, we just want you to... Just come straight on board. I was like, "Oh, man." And I was like, "Do you guys look at anybody else?" He said, "Oh, we auditioned, I think, Robbie Mungaseva."
Oh, real.
And Dave Funny. But no, Paul was like, "No, well."
Did they actually audition them or they were just thinking about
them? I've heard about
that. I think
really?
So.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know about that.
Maybe do a read through or something like that.
Oh, yeah. Interesting.
And, Paul was like, "Oh, I thought I'll give you a ring." And I think it was Jermaine took the most convincing. But then he got in contact with Brett because we'd just worked on Two Little Boys and Brett's like, "No, he's great." So had some people in my corner. It was awesome.
Awesome. Oh, it's funny how they didn't audition you when they were auditioning everyone else. They must have already loved you and were just trying to make their mind up.
You know? It's not surprising. He's very lovable.
I agree. I agree.
No.
And then what was the first thing we shot? Because we never did. You weren't in the that testy thingy we did that Taika directed.
The pilot.
The pilot thingy. It was a bit of a weird pilot though, wasn't it? Because it never screened. Pilot's normally your first episode that goes out.
Oh, not that.
Not that though.
Have we found that yet?
No, I haven't put a lot of research into it. We're trying to drum up a bit of interest around it, and there is not a lot of it. Well, yeah. In fact, nobody's mentioned it except for you and me.
Okay, well, yeah. But anyway, when did we first meet? Was it at a table read?
It must have been. Must have been at that official table read at Avalon, that long table.
Yeah,
that's when you guys met, but I'm pretty sure you and I had already met because of Tim Foley.
That's right.
And because you had been in the, I think you were at the World of People premiere.
Yeah.
And I saw you after that at a pub.
Yeah, man.
And we talked about you doing that. Was it?
Was a lot of people before Paranormal?
Yes.
True.
Yes, it was.
It was there.
Yeah, I did a timeline. I wouldn't have remembered that, but yeah, it was. Yes, and we had a yarn about that, and I feel like our mutual friend Tim got married in around about that time. We stayed up all night watching, and the rugby was on about time as well. So that would have been 2015 too.
Yep.
Hey, because it's been
really fast.
Yeah, look at that. Holy. I'm good with timelines. Yeah. My memory's right.
But I'd assume that I'd seen you on heaps of other things before, and you're like, "Nah, mate, I'm a preschool teacher." I was like, "What?"
Yeah.
True story.
Yeah, that's it. You're going to a room, you're like, "You're going to bed a lie." "Oh, yeah, I love this stuff you've been in. You're one of my favourites." Yeah.
"Oh, man."
"No. Really? Are you sure?" "I'm sure I've seen you." "No, I'm sure."
Yeah.
And how was your experience then getting on? Because in terms of how you found the character of Maaka, like we've spoken about how we had to try and find what it was that we were doing, and essentially that was just from doing episodes and then eventually working it out as you went through it, you know.
That was the same similar process for me.
Yeah.
I didn't really, it was this kind of stumbling through some kind of idea of something that in the lead up, I was watching Brooklyn Nine-Nine.
Yeah.
I was just kind of trying to nail the real deadpan face of mm-hmm. Captain Holt.
Yeah.
And just trying to basically just not crack up, which, you know, I was the worst at.
That.
I was the most corpsing, you know, ever. Just little like coaching things from Jermaine would go, oh, more Winston Peters, more sort of Winston. And I was like, okay.
That is a great.
Yeah,
and I think it was the old Winston Peters.
No, yeah,
not the new one.
Not really known as Winston Peters.
Yeah.
What do they call it? Winnie Blue Peters.
The Winnie Blue Peters.
The Winfield Blue Peters.
Yeah, the other guy, Cigaretti. Oh, man. But it just kind of evolved through doing eps and just trying to stay dry and in the pocket.
Yeah,
because we did have a couple of rehearsals. Remember before we first started?
Fill me in on those.
We practiced. We went through a couple of scenes with just you, me, and Maaka.
Right.
And Jermaine gave us some ideas.
Oh yeah, that vaguely rings a bell.
Yeah.
What room were we in?
A white one.
Okay.
At Avalon.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. And that room at the end. That's the where the kitchen table thing is.
Oh yes.
Before you go outside the back with the truck.
And then what was it like when you actually when you knew that you had it? What was your feeling like when you've got the role? Because I'm assuming you didn't really know Jermaine, you didn't know Taika. Were you sort of at around about 9 or 10 on the scale of pure fear?
Actually, I'd met Jermaine and Taika years before, and had a little cameo as a fight man character on Eagle versus Shark.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah. That was fun. That was the first time I'd met Jermaine and Taika, and we came into this whole day of like motion capture work, kind of like a fight man, like a version of Mortal Kombat. You know, more tinny and I played this Māori warrior character. So I'd met them before, but not had. Oh, and then again, a few times they did the show at what was then Downstage called the Untold Tales of Maui, and there was a two-hander. There was Taika and Jermaine, and I pretty much volunteered to watch that show every night to be an usher.
What year would that have been?
Oh, it had to have been around maybe 2002 or 3.
Right.
Yeah, because I mentioned it when we got to start shooting on the first season. I was like, I really loved your guys' show back in the day, Untold Tales of Maui. And he goes, oh, you remember that? That's a long time ago. I was like, yeah, man. He goes, oh, if we ever remount it, you do want to go with it? I was like, yeah, shit, yeah. I'm keen. Yeah, so, but past that, you know, didn't really.
And they've sort of grown into something quite big in between 2002 and when we had a crack.
Yeah. So, you know,
I think what he's saying is he wasn't scared.
He wasn't scared, yeah.
We were a little bit excited or like just totally not even bothered.
Just buzzing. Just
buzzing,
yeah. Cool.
Yeah.
Not so much fear, just buzzing and excitement.
Yeah.
I was like, this could be. Quite big, yeah.
It was pretty mean.
Yeah.
I'm trying to remember what the first scene was that we did together, but it must have been on.
Well, surely. Do you remember the first scene that we shot?
Was it the keypad? Was it the first introduction of
the pin
numbers?
Would that have been it? Because we started on location at Cop Circles.
So I thought did we come into the office with the thing? Pulsing plant.
Yeah, maybe.
Actually,
but I felt like
my first day was on. My first day was on Cop Circles.
It would have been because they always wrap a location before you move, right? So unless it was wet weather, which it wasn't because the weather was so good, then we would have just shot out
that
farm.
But we didn't do the crazy, the weed-eating the when you brought the weed spray out, that was towards the end of that filming that episode, wasn't it? When you got those really sore eyeballs. Remember they straight put that stuff in your eyes?
Yeah. Oh, that's right.
Yeah. It wasn't all on the same night?
No. I think it was a couple of days. But, yeah, I think all the location stuff was first.
Yeah.
Because, yeah, otherwise you have to pay for a location when you aren't using it, which you wouldn't do.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Yeah. I'm pretty sure it was like walking onto set and seeing the art department fake eviscerated cow on the ground
going, that's right.
Yeah, and thinking like, oh, I didn't think it would be that kind of vibe, like straight to the gore. I thought, oh, yeah, isn't that a fun cop and that is program with that? Yeah. And then I was like, no, of course it is, Maaka. You've seen Shadows. It's like, yep, sweet. And
but that reminds me that they did feel like they'd started too hardcore with the horror. Do you remember that? Yes. So when we went into season two, it was like they're going to bring it back and make it a bit more family.
But also didn't they say they thought it was going to be like that, but then because the plant aliens were so ridiculous that they couldn't maintain that. It wasn't actually scary. It was just kind of laughable.
It was just a demon girl that was a bit scary for the kids in that. Yeah.
Well, I actually got surprised that a lot of my mates who are all parents, they're like, oh, our kids love it. And I was like, you need to watch that. It's quite gruesome. It's not scary that. No, they think it's funny.
We're also pretty silly.
Yeah.
It's a good mix because I remember growing up watching, what were the scary ones when we watched? Used to grow up.
The Goonies.
Well, yes. Mm. But there was this, Doctor Who.
Yeah. I was freaked out by Doctor Who.
It was scary.
Yeah. The theme song, man. I used to run behind the couch.
Yeah, totally. So you'd be enjoying it and knowing it wasn't real, but at the same time you'd be scared. Mm. And I liked that when I was a kid.
Yeah. Actually, just on a side note, just yesterday some guy commented on the thing I did. He goes, "You are Doctor Who, bro. Get a life."
I didn't get that.
And I was
"Could
like,
you try again?
Could you try again?"
Yeah, he says, "You are Doctor Who, bro. Get a life." I was like, "What does that even mean?" I was like,
"Who said that?"
To some random guy who commented on a post that I did,
right?
Taking the piss out of Brian's interpretation or Brian Tarmacki's interpretation of the haka. And he said, "You are Doctor Who, bro. Get a life." I was like, "What does that mean?"
Yeah. Did you ask him?
Yeah, but I think it's funny because it's like, do you think I'm a character who's a 2,000-year-old Time Lord who has different reincarnations of different lives? Because that's like weird and quite meta in a way. What a nerd, eh?
That's quite a good I got some insults. So for some reason, someone reposted my Get Your Vaccine song from like 2 years ago.
Uh-huh.
And all of these amazing people came out of the woodwork. Someone was like, "Who is that person wearing man face?"
Oh, it's
like,
wow.
It's like, is man that like,
face?
Yeah, it's like, is that like blackface but man face?
Oh.
And then someone else is like, "I don't know whether he/she or it, what it's on about." And but I don't want to listen to the lesbian ideology. It's
did you have some good back and forth with those people? I don't imagine you let any of those comments go through as a keeper.
I said, "Thank you so much for reposting my song, Get Your Vaccine. The plethora of comments on this thread has brightened my day for days." Yeah. And then I did a love heart, a rainbow, big gay rainbow emoji, and another love heart because they don't want me to be nice to them. That will drive them more mad.
Exactly, yeah, exactly. That's right. They'll be expecting a fight.
Yeah. What a comeback, Doctor Who.
Doctor what?
Your man face, Doctor Who. Man, you spent ages thinking of that. Comeback, eh?
Yeah.
What a burn, dude.
Should we talk about how we felt about in our scenes together? The office, not you, not just you, Karen.
No, I don't.
Mark is here, he's our guest. Man, you've got to be more polite.
Yes, I'd love to talk about that.
How did you feel about the Maaka since you're the guest? You can go first.
just kind of like, nervous actually.
Right.
Yeah. I don't know why. It's just the tiny setup was always sort of awkwardly, can't move. There was quite often like a boom right here, another B camera here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is when we're in your secret office. Yeah. It was pretty random. Yeah. And there was definitely an order, right? I think you had to go first, then a cam, then a boom up. We actually built a false wall in.
Yes. Because also we had like, it was Sam Spicer, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
First season, but then the boom operator got was very, very tall and enormous. That's so that made right. it a lot. That was Nick.
Nick, yeah.
Yeah.
Nick, yeah.
Yeah.
That's Mummy. Right. Yeah, there was not a lot of room. It got very, very warm in there.
yeah.
But it was really fun, wasn't it? I remember that it was always always a lot of fun. And then once it got into the improvising side of things, was always really
yeah.
good as well.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. And I enjoyed that you would always laugh.
Yeah. Always. always. Just, yeah. Always kind of feeling nervous at, I don't know, man, just being the kind of like fixed on the spot. Well, yeah. You know, the first couple of runs of the, and then you're right. Once we nailed the formula of how it went.
Yeah.
As a thing, but you know, the first few goes is like, oh shit, and I was just kind of weirdly, you know, like what's his name? Will Ferrell as Ricky Bobby, and he, you know, he's like, I don't know what to do with my hands and yeah, Taylor Dagger Knights yeah. and shit. And it was just like, so just don't move. Oh shit.
Right.
So that said, did you enjoy doing the bit where you got to recreate the cow getting stuck in the tree? Because
yes.
that is still one of my favourite events.
Stuff like that just really loosened me up.
Yeah,
know?
Yeah, yeah.
And you're very good at sound effects too.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, yeah, man. Brought those out.
Yeah, man. I love it. It was great. The more, and you know, Jermaine just like just really pumped the ridiculousness of that. Just commit to, you know, and then, you know, the cow and then the UFO and the cow and, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
And all the gravitational pulls getting quite.
yeah.
You yeah. coach through ridiculous shit like that. I love it.
I loved about Maaka was, Sarge, was that it was, you know, something would happen, we'd come in and have a yarn about it to you, and you'd automatically assume that it was a ridiculously paranormal thing,
yeah.
which is such a stretch. And then by the end of it, you'd be right.
What yeah, I love sure about, enough. Yeah, what I love about Sarge is, he's so nerdy and he loves that whole world of the occult and the
yeah.
supernatural. And, yeah, I love how I remember, like, the introduction of the, I first saw Ghost when I was 9. My brother
drew that picture.
yeah, and he's got a picture that, what's Jermaine's son's name again? Sofa?
Yeah.
Sofa? Yeah, he drew, like, this picture of a gentleman ghost with a little ghost dog, like yeah. skeleton, kind of beautiful.
That's right.
He's like, there it is. Yeah, my brother drew a picture. of
Do you believe sand. In ghosts?
No.
Because I remember in that one of the very first scenes in that office was the one and only time I ever swore on the TV show.
Oh, really?
And
oh,
I said yeah. to you, which I would never do now, just as a friend, but also certainly not to my Sarge. I don't give a shit, Sarge. Do you remember that?
That's
one?
Right.
I don't remember
and
that.
I don't know. That was when we were still working out what who our characters were, and it's like I worked out very quickly that was not what I do.
No, not swearing up Sarge. Yeah, that no. was.
oh, I don't give a shit.
But all of that said, you did try to show me your pubes at one point. So.
That's right. They turned grey. In fact, we should cut away to that clip right now. Potty Jake.
I hate to say this, but I think the evidence points to
a party bus.
Party ghosts.
Poltergeists! It's German for noisy spirits.
There's no such thing as spirits.
I saw a ghost once, Minogue. That's what turned my hair white.
Your hair's pitch black, Sarge.
Yeah, well, they're in there. Trust me. But you know what else? The experience turned a couple of my pubes white from fear.
I'll take your word for it, Sarge.
Minogue.
No.
Copy that.
Which we will, but yeah, that was a good one. That I like that whole series when you say, and look at this photo. What do you think this is?
And I think
it's an alien.
Hubcap. Yeah, hubcap. I think it's a hubcap. What about you, Minogue? What do you reckon? Yeah, I reckon it's a hubcap.
I don't care what you think.
Laughing at our own shit.
Yeah.
Hey, got a couple of fan questions for you, Sarge, just to round out this episode.
Let's go.
Does Sergeant Maaka have any ambitions to. Oh, now this is from Richard Gagnon. Rich one. He's back.
He's good.
This is off the X or the Twitter. Does Sarge have any ambitions to rise higher in the ranks of the Wellington Police?
Oh, I don't know. I think because he's such an egalitarian kind of guy, I think he's happy where he is.
And then it would be like, what are the chances of him being able to do the paranormal thing, which he loves, anywhere else in the police department? If he got promoted, he wouldn't be able to do that anymore, would he?
No, he wouldn't.
Hey.
Is that Since when do you work for the police?
Well, I don't know. I just assumed.
Me too. Well, just, I don't know how it works either.
I mean, none of it's true. None of this is true. So I'm just doing some answers to these questions. Like, he's asked me a question about Sergeant Maaka. Sergeant Maaka's not real.
Mm.
There's no point even answering. I shouldn't even have asked this question. Yeah. Does your grandmother have any more cookies left in her? I don't know what that means.
Oh, does he mean the donuts?
Donuts, Nana? Yeah.
Must be.
What was that one?
Zombie cops.
Yeah.
Oh, that's right.
Like one of the debriefings, and it got to like quite personal. There was like, you know, whoever took my donuts from the.
They clearly said Maaka.
Maaka, permanent Maaka. She hasn't got many donuts left in her, so.
Yeah, so that's a no for the biscuits, but maybe some donuts.
Maybe. This one from Griff at Karen Griff. Did Maaka realise he was going to become such a sex symbol? I dipped a toe and looked into the scary world of Tumblr Wellington Paranormal fandom and quickly ran away, as those people are raunchy. There were a lot of very thirsty followers for you.
Wow.
Yeah. I don't know what you're going to be doing on the ride home.
I had no idea.
Signing up for Tumblr.
Well, I had a Tumblr account like years ago, but I haven't checked it out. I'm going to go and have a look at it now. Thirsty, eh?
Wow. Yeah, thirsty is.
Wow. I had no idea, mate. But yeah, we'll do some research.
What's that thing you do? An OnlyFans.
Oh, yeah.
You could do that.
You got your own uniform.
That's right.
Yeah, take Paul it off.
Gave us all our uniforms.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, sweet. Sign me up. Sweet,
just
all right.
Sarge ASMR. Yeah.
Have you got anything to promote before we go? What about your handles on socials?
My Instagram handle is Maaka Pohatu.
At Maaka Pohatu. That's pretty easy. And Karen, what's your Instagram handle?
Karen Larry NZ, I think.
That is you, yep. Yeah. Mine is Mr. Mike Minogue. I'm on the Hauraki Big Show, at Hauraki Big Show. You got anything to promote, hey, Larry?
Just world peace.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, man.
I reckon. Yeah. Also want to thank Monica for creating all of our stings. Also want to thank Paul Yates and Jermaine Clement for allowing us to create this podcast. Yeah. This podcast was recorded at the Frank Studios of Frank Podcasts here in Tamaki Makaurau. If you want to get involved and make a podcast yourself, you can reach out to Potty Jake on our socials. Lovely to see you.
We love talking to you. You're a great person.
Oh, thank you.
Oh.
Thanks, guys.
You're all right.
Thank you.